So I'm here today to talk to you about glycobiology, and specifically the glycoscience of women's health, which is an initiative that we're really working on over in the Glycobiology Research and Training Center, of which I am the co-director. So we often think about carbohydrates as something that we eat and break down, but really carbohydrates also build us up. They're an integral part of how we function and who we are. They're a major building block of life, really the most abundant on the planet when you start considering things like cellulose. All living things express glycans, and their composition impacts cellular identity and function. They're part of normal physiology and disease. Glycans and glycan processing enzymes are common as drugs and drug targets. Think about heparin. And as in biochemistry and molecular biology, the study of glycans spans every discipline and every area of research. So show of hands, how many have had formal education in molecular biology? Almost everybody. Okay, how about glycans? Okay, three of us. So that's why we're here at the Glycobiology Research and Training Center. And we connect not only folks here at UCSD, but at institutions across San Diego and in California in general. And we're over here located on this campus in the Israni Biomedical Research Facility on the fourth floor. And despite the fact that you see me surrounded by all of these men, it is in fact true that most of them are working on some aspect of women's health, sex differences research, or reproductive science, or infant health. To introduce you to the glycoscience of women's health and what we're trying to do in this area, our objective is to stimulate and support pioneering research collaborations and support the trainees that use the science of glycans to advance women's health. So we've had a little bit of seed support for our growing initiative. Our program manager, Jonathan Vega, has been key to bringing all of this together. We've got a philanthropic gift from Nissi and Ajit Varkey, for which we're very grateful. The Borough's Welcome Fund has also given us a little bit of money, and I'm hoping to convince them to give us a little bit more. And the University of California Office of the President, UCOP, also supported this through the multi-campus research initiative. So through that initiative, we were able to do some research projects to allow for pilot funding in our core facility that does analytics of the major classes of animal glycans. We're also able to support some of our education functions as well as travel and support for our annual symposium. And so these are the research projects and sort of the spectrum of work that we've been doing, ranging from the vaginal microbiome to maternal fetal tolerance, preeclampsia, how antibody glycosylation impacts infectious diseases like COVID, as well as things like pelvic floor and urinary tract disorders. And like I was mentioning, we have a core facility that actually assists in the analysis of all the major classes of human glycans. So if you start to find in your omics analyses that you don't actually see the glycans there, but you see some glycoproteins or some other types of glycosylated molecules, you can email me and I can try to help connect you so that you can look at the glycans in addition to the DNA and the RNA and the other molecules of interest. So our glyco bootcamp provides specialized research training. It's a two-week hands-on summer workshop at UCSD where the trainees come in and actually learn in our core facility how to analyze all the major classes of glycans. In the past couple years, we've been doing actually this based on research projects, based on research samples. And the project there has been related to sex differences in mouse models of diabetes. But we're going to be expanding that and hopefully centering it more in the context of women's health. So I'm in the aging module here, and so I thought it would be important as I transition into telling you a little bit about my own research on the human vaginal microbiota to sort of mention that the vaginal microbiome changes as we age. And I'm going to focus mainly on the reproductive age and pregnancy in the next few slides. But as we've been discussing through most of this day, estrogen and hormones impact how the vaginal microbiome coexists with the epithelium. And this can become really important in menopause. But I only have very beginning projects in that area, so I won't talk about those today. Now, I would be remiss if I didn't mention that we've had 20 talks, but no one has said the word vagina yet. We do have many aspects of women's health to cover, of course, but I want to tell you a little bit about the vaginal microbiota. So in most women, there's a lactobacillus dominant microbiota, but in some women, this condition called bacterial vaginosis develops, and it's actually a third of us, almost, that can experience this condition, which can kind of come and go. But it's been linked with a huge variety of health complications, including sexually transmitted infections of virtually all of them. And this actually includes the development and aggressiveness of pelvic cancers, cervical cancer, urinary tract infections, ascending infections in pregnancy, preterm birth, really the list goes on and on, pelvic inflammatory disease, endometritis, infertility. And the problem is that we really don't understand the etiology of this condition. And so you can treat it and sort of the symptoms sort of go away for a bit, but in more than half of women, there are recurrences within a matter of weeks. And so this is a real problem. And my lab is mostly doing basic science to study the bacteria that are and the processes that are at the root of this. So you're asking yourself, how did the glycans come into this? After a couple pictures, I will tell you. But first, I want to stun you with these beautiful scanning electron micrograph images where we can see the surface of the epithelium, and these arrows are pointing to lactobacilli, so you can see they're kind of spaced few and far between, and the epithelial surface itself is more or less smooth. When you look at a sample from an individual with BV, instead you see something more like this, where the epithelial surfaces are literally covered in bacteria. And if you look even closer, you start to see like that they're connected and that there are, you know, many different types of bacteria that are present here. This is work from Soumya Agarwal, a postdoc, and Warren Lewis, who's actually the senior author on this paper that's coming together, about the cell adherent microbiota in BV. So I'm not going to go into all the details of the sequencing and all that stuff, where we're sort of trying to show that there are different niches where bacteria live, but instead kind of take this back to the clinical setting where the signs of BV from the physician standpoint are, you know, the presence of clue cells, a higher than normal vaginal pH, which is because the lactobacilli are no longer in an abundant manner. The so-called whiff test, which is essentially a fishy odor, and abnormal discharge, which I'm going to get more into, which we think is the result of glycan-degrading enzymes. So I got interested as a glycobiologist in studying bacterial vaginosis when I first started my lab, and I had noticed in the clinical literature that it had been reproduced a number of times that individuals with bacterial vaginosis have high sialidase activity. And moreover, that if you take among those individuals that have bacterial vaginosis, you can kind of separate them into ones that have low sialidase activity and ones that have higher sialidase activity. And those that have high activity have these early pregnancy losses and preterm birth. And this enzyme activity has also been independently associated with reduction of mucus viscosity, increased risk of preterm birth, placental infection, as well as recurrent bacterial vaginosis. So what is sialidase? Sialidase is an enzyme that removes sialic acid residues. So don't let this confuse you, because there are a lot of different kinds of glycans here. But glycoproteins can have serine or threonine-linked glycans called O-glycans, or asparagine-linked glycans called N-glycans. And both of those can have sialic acids, which are present on the sort of on the terminal ends of these carbohydrate chains. This did not come out the way it should have, but sialidases, we've studied the biochemistry of some of the sialidases that are present both by using clinical specimens themselves to look at what the what kind of substrates they act upon, as well as looking at the bacteria and trying to understand, you know, which genes produce the enzyme activity, what it acts upon, et cetera. And so we've been able to essentially see that these sialidases act on sialic acids in, you know, virtually all the different settings that we have studied. And they can act on things like mucins, immunoglobulins, but also on cell surfaces. So in this image, you're seeing what we call the glycocalyx, which is literally the sugar coating of cells. And so unlike the other one, which was a scanning electron micrograph, this is a transmission electron micrograph, so it looks a little bit different. And you can see with this particular ruthenium red staining, this fuzzy coat, which are the glycans that are present on the cell surface. In bacterial vaginosis, you instead see these bacteria in close proximity to the cells. And what's interesting is you even see that these bacteria themselves, you can see their glycan coat, but when you look at the cells on the human cell surface, these vaginal epithelial cells are no longer glycosylated. And so when we actually look at those N and O glycans that we can isolate from these specimens, we do in fact see when we measure sialic acid content that both the N glycans and the O glycans of the individuals with BV shown in blue here have, you know, very significantly reduced levels of sialic acids present. So we've also started to look at some of the underlying carbohydrates present here and have been able to also show that in addition to sialidases, there are also galactosidases and hexosaminidases, additional glycan-degrading enzymes that continue to kind of chop away at these glycan chains. And we've been able to show with collaborators at UC Davis that in addition to seeing that these sialylated glycan chains are reduced in BV, we see evidence that there's an accumulation of the degraded in glycan intermediates. So once you take off the sialic acid and these galactose residues here, you're left with this structure here, which is elevated in BV. And then one of these N-acetylgalactosamines comes off. And then, we see evidence of this accumulation of the degraded glycans. My lab is now sort of studying which bacteria are doing these processes. And we've just been able to, with collaborators, kind of access genetics in some of the bacteria that are involved in bacterial vaginosis. And these are like pretty challenging to work with because they're anaerobic. So we are like in the lab in this anaerobic chamber, like a big vinyl bag that people work in. And so we're really excited to have these new advancements and to be able to connect with folks that are doing this high resolution glycan analysis. And with that, if anyone has any glycan interested projects, please send me an email. We'd be happy to help you. Thank you.